Welcome back to Urban Lifestyle Cafe. This is your bougie black brother, Michael Carr, and this session will be closing out the last of our Oscar-nominated movies. We'll be talking about Manchester by the Sea, LaLa Land, and Lion. My co-host Alicia will be finishing those out. We didn't get a chance to see Heartbreak Ridge, which we're not going to see. And the other one, Hell or High Water, we didn't get a chance to see that as of yet. So that's going to really take a while. And Arrival, which was an amazing movie we saw earlier last year, which we didn't expect to be actually nominated. But stay tuned for Urban Lifestyle Cafe. To Urban Lifestyle Cafe. I'm Michael Carr, and I'm here with my co-host, Alicia.
Hello.
And today, like we said, we're closing out our Oscar-nominated films. So we had an opportunity to, like Alicia said to me earlier, was to binge on a couple of movies.
On the plane.
Yep, on a plane.
To Florence.
Florence, Italy.
Yeah.
So we had a chance to actually go with three different movies.
Well,
saw three.
I saw four. Three.
You saw three.
Yeah.
I saw two. So my main two was Manchester by the Sea, mm-hmm. as well as LaLa Land. And Alicia had a chance to see Lion. So you get her exclusive thoughts on Lion without me. But we at least saw LaLa Land as well as Manchester by the Sea.
Yeah, I was kind of excited. It was when we got on the plane and was about to take off. And I was show Michael. I was like, oh, look at all the movies we didn't see for free.
Yep, and it was all lined up, so they had a whole bunch of them. They had a lot of them that we already saw, so yep, I didn't want to get excited over that and go, hey, you know what, let me see something I've seen already. But we had to get the Oscar-nominated one, so it was a good opportunity to close that out.
Yeah, I didn't even get to go to sleep on the goddamn plane.
yeah, because it was about 9 hours, so that made that kind of interesting. So I really want to start with Lion first, because that's the one I didn't see. And Alicia can walk us through, because I'll be asking her questions, because I want to inquiry about that movie in particular. If you didn't know, it was about a young man in India.
True story.
True story that was traveling with his brother.
Mm-hmm.
Got lost, and in short, I'm doing the short version, and wound up in Australia, but in without any education of where he was, what town he found his way back.
The movie really was, like you said, it's about a young little boy who loved his brother, and his mom worked, and they really were trying to help their moms survive, you know, finding things, you know, here and there to basically to make a living, to survive. And so in the movie, the little boy, he was so adorable, loved his brother so much. Every time his brother tried to make some money to help his mom, he was like begging his brother to go with him.
Mm-hmm.
And so in this situation, the little boy begged his brother, because his brother had to go do something. I don't know. Can't remember exactly what, but he's like, please, please, I can lift this. I can do this. I'm strong. And so the brother let him go with him. And they went to the train station, because
mm-hmm.
you've seen previews of that. And he told his brother, okay, wait here, because his brother was really tired. So he fell asleep. He said, so wait here, and I'll come back. And the little boy fell asleep and woke up, and his brother didn't come back. And he got on the train looking for him, and the train just took off. And the train just kept moving and kept going and going and going and going and going. And it just showed how the little boy, which was really amazing, survived on the streets of India.
So he was away from his town.
Right.
Got far away in India and actually just start surviving.
Yeah, he knew how to survive from when he was living in his own little town.
Right.
And it was amazing until, you know, they found him and they put him in a child.
Yeah, like an orphanage.
Yeah, orphanage.
Yeah.
And they said this couple wanted to adopt him in Australia and totally changed his life. And you could, and they show you how he went there and how he grew up and how he learned and everything. They adopted another Indian boy, mm-hmm. which was a big problem. He was a problem child. And so they fell in love with him. The mother loved her first adopted son. She loved him.
Right.
And so
that was Nicole Kidman, right?
Right. And she was amazing through the whole story.
That's why she got nominated.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool.
She was really amazing. And it was a good thing is that's her country anyway, you know. She's from Australia.
Yeah.
Australia. But it showed how he grew up and showed how there was something that he was his favorite treat in India triggered him to figure out that where he came, that he was where he got lost and who his brother was.
Right, right.
And so that started his adventure to trying to find who he was.
So when he again, the memory of the food that he ate triggered the fact that, well, this is probably where I'm from.
He knew because he was in school becoming a cook, you know, becoming a chef. And that's when he realized he was at a party, at an Indian party, where a bunch of his friends was Indian. And that's when he realized, when they went into the kitchen, he saw the little treats. He knew, like, that was his favorite treat. And he would always tell his brother, can we buy me my favorite treat?
So did that jar him to say, I want to get back to... What made it...
Cause that jarred him to realize that he...
He wanted to go back.
No, he didn't know himself.
Oh, he didn't know himself.
He didn't know until he figured out, oh my God, my brother. Mm-hmm. That triggered his brother. And that's when it triggered... That's when he went, not crazy, but he was just, like, focused on trying to find...
So he got obsessed then.
Yeah, he got really obsessed with trying to find himself. And the people were trying to tell him, well, if you remember something, why don't you do a map, a radius, mm-hmm. Try to find where you're from? And he started gradually doing that. And he still couldn't figure out where he got from until... Like at the very, because he had a girlfriend and they were both in love and he was like, listen, I can't get, he was just so in tune and trying to find himself
right.
that it took him away from his relationship, from his mom and his girlfriend.
Right.
And so that's when he realized that he had to find himself. And when he did, it was like he didn't realize it was further out than what it was.
Right, right.
So the radius he was looking in, it was way a little further out. And when he finally figured out what it was, he was like so excited.
So did he travel back there or was he still doing like using the internet or whatever?
He used the internet, Google World, you know, mm-hmm. Google Earth we'd use.
Right.
But once he figured out who he was and where he was from, he went back there.
Right.
On his own. He didn't contact nobody because he didn't know
who was there to contact.
Right. And he didn't know if they still there. But when he got there, he remembered everything. He remembered where he lived. It was, I mean, because he did it so much.
Right.
And you know, as a routine, you grow up. So when he got off that train, he followed the path that he remembered. Mm-hmm. And when he went to the house where he was at, there was goats living in there.
Damn. Okay.
So, but a man came to him and said, asked him who he was looking for. No, the lady was asking who he was looking for. Then a man came to him and he said, you speak English? He said, yeah. And he explained to him who he was looking for. He said, come with me. And he took him to where his mom and his sister was at.
Wow.
Yeah. It was really, really good.
So what made it the most interesting? Because, you know, the actor, I really like him.
I love him.
Dev Patel.
Yeah, I love him.
Really good actor. Very emotional. He always shows up, you know, as a very, very good actor. So, you know, when he shows up in things, you're kind of excited and go, ooh, that's the dude from... Slumdog Millionaire.
Yeah,
that's the guy from The Last Airbender. Yeah. Or what's the HBO show?
Yeah, the one.
I forget.
You know what I'm talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah, 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 yeah. We watch all of these shows. Yeah. But yeah, so this guy, he's a very, very good actor. So it was, you know, when he was in there and they said he was nominated, it wasn't like, oh, they just put him there just because. No, this guy is a very, very good actor.
He is. And it was, I really enjoyed it because, you know, it's a true story, but it really had some substance to it. You really understood and relate to what he was going through.
And the fact, because what made it interesting, too, is we did see the 60-minute piece on the actual guy who went through it.
Yes, we did.
Which was, that's what made it more interesting. Yes, that's when we said, wow, maybe this is something we need to check out.
Yes, we did.
You know, but I had so many other movies, so I was checking on my other one out. But Alicia was at least able to see Lion, so I appreciate her input on there. But I'll get around to see this, but
I will watch it again because it was just so good.
It was that good?
Yeah, because even when they were talking Indian, you could still have, there was still a flow to the story that you could follow and understood.
Right, right.
You know, you understood or understand what it was going through without saying, okay, I'm missing some of the subtitles. It wasn't that serious. It was really about how the flow of the movie, because you could just see the little boy just running around and doing all the crazy. You was like, oh my God, this little boy is so smart. So that's why I said I would watch it again. It was definitely a good movie.
Outstanding. Yeah, so that was Lion. So what was Lion, though?
What was Lion?
Why they call it Lion?
I don't know.
Well, good for you.
I have to figure that out. I just seen the movie. I was like, we didn't bother to find out what the title meant.
Well, usually the name is based on something, but okay. So that I found that one just interesting. So very, very, very good. I appreciate Leisha actually giving us our input on that one. The next one was Manchester by the Sea. So Manchester by the Sea was getting a lot of awards prior to the Oscars.
Buzz, a lot of buzz.
It was a lot of great buzz with Affleck's brother, Casey.
Yeah, Casey
Affleck, which that he played such a tremendous role in there. And, you know, since we saw a lot of these other movies, we was kind of like, really? Let's see how good of a role that he actually did.
Well, Casey only, I mean, he's so picky about what he does.
But he's a very good actor.
He is.
And I think we give him more credit because his brother's just average. He's such
That's
a
true.
Better actor than his brother that whenever you see him, you'd be like, wow, this guy really can act.
Yeah, it's true.
But, you know, compared to his brother. But Casey's a very good actor. I think I haven't seen too much movies he's been in that I didn't enjoy. Because he still has that same demeanor. He puts enough emotion in there that he seems relatable, too. So that's why I really like the actions of Casey. So, Manchester by the Sea. So, quick synopsis, if you don't know, guy from the Massachusetts area, Boston area, him, his brother, and his father, and his mom, just hardworking, blue-collar guys, fishing, boating. His brother dies, and he has a son, and he has to go back to the town where he's from and takes care of his nephew.
Yeah.
That's the simple part of it.
Right, that's
it. But the complexity of this movie, I thought was pretty, pretty amazing. And this is an original screenplay. I think written and directed by Kenneth Lorigan, the one guy. He just wrote the whole thing, directed it, and it was really pretty deep. So when you checked it out, Alicia, because you was kind of like, until we kind of talked a little, but what was your opinion about the Manchester by the Sea?
I mean, it was all right. It was all right. I mean, they would say it was a tearjerker, not to me. Mm-hmm. I mean, I cry. You know how I be crying in movies.
But you didn't relate, though. Usually when cry about...
There's a lot of movies that still will give it to me, will at least give me something. But I guess it's because, I mean, the only thing that they would probably expect for you to cry was when you found out about what happened to his children. I think that was the part where they expect for you to really get emotional about it.
The thing is, the whole, if you kind of feel bad for him. So again, what I'm saying to you is, I don't know any movie that you cried about that you didn't relate to. This was kind of hard for you to relate to, knowing the other movies that you felt emotional about. So I understand why you was like, "Hey, it's okay," and wasn't a tearjerker.
I cry about live this, and then just about every movie we go to that gives you that little bit of tears. I cry about everything.
Crying Moonlight.
What's that?
Moonlight.
Yes, I did.
Why?
Because the young boy, he finally realized at the end
that,
you know, he asked that question. Am I, you know, what he asked? That was emotional.
But he asked that throughout the movie. But yeah. I got you, though. I got you. So, and you was like, this is like an okay movie. So, this is how I saw Manchester by the Sea. What he started it off was just this ordinary guy who was a janitor or took care of a couple of buildings in Boston. He didn't really have much. He was just a hardworking, kind of like dull type guy. Hang out in the bar. And, you know, he was just nobody. He was just an any guy. You know, and that's what you saw him as. And then when he had to rush back home and say his brother died, you know, so it took you like, damn, okay, his brother died. What happened? Then you find out his brother has been sick for a while. He had some kind of heart disease.
Yeah, heart disease, something like that.
You see that he had a problem. Then you find out he was married before. But all of these is slowly building up. Then you find out that they show flashbacks. Most of this was based on flashbacks. So it'd be flashback.
Right.
Which brought you to knowing why he was in the position that he was in. So he was like, I'm not moving back there taking care of my nephew. But his brother left everything
to him.
To him.
You have to take care of his son.
And he
nephew.
Was like, yep. No way. Hell no. I can't do this. And you're like, what is this dude's problem? And you slowly start building.
Yeah.
And then he, you know, when he's dealing with his nephew, they had a relationship before, but he's older and he still don't know how to deal with it. And as the stories start building, you find little things about this guy because they didn't want to hire him. And they was like, well, he divorced he was separated from his wife. So you kind of like, he's an asshole. So I probably that was the problem, him being an asshole. Then the flashbacks was him and his children and his wife. And it didn't seem like he was an asshole other than being drunk, just like, you know.
Any other typical
up in Boston's drinking and just chilling. So it was still whatever. But then it gets to the point that you start understanding how and why he's feeling the way he is. His children died in a fire because he was drunk and left the house and left the heater on.
No, it wasn't the heater. I think it was
the fireplace. Right, the fireplace.
Right.
Because the gate wasn't in front.
Right, the gate. There's a normally where you, apparently... Where he had a fireplace, there's usually a little gate in front. We have
one
of those.
When the sparks pop out on the rug.
Exactly. And he forgot to put the gate onto the fireplace. And so what happened was that caused a fire in the house, which the wife was able to get out. His wife.
But the children was upstairs. Not.
Yeah, they were upstairs.
And so they wasn't able to get the children.
Yeah.
So the children burned to death. He had two little girls and one little boy.
And an infant boy, yes.
Infant boy.
Yes. And so they blamed him.
So the city or the town
blamed him for the death of his children.
But the cops and everything said, this wasn't premeditated. It wasn't intentional.
It was an accident.
It was an accident.
And he felt guilty.
And he felt guilty and the town blamed him, so he had to leave.
And he blamed himself.
Yes.
So he blamed himself.
He was in turmoil constantly.
Yes, he was. That's why he didn't want to come.
But once you saw that, didn't you understand from the beginning why he just wanted to be away? He didn't want to be in the town.
He didn't want to be in the town.
He didn't want to deal with his family.
Because he couldn't face it. It was just devastating.
He could never get over it.
Yes, he couldn't. And his wife tried to mend the relationship.
She had another child.
And she felt bad.
By someone else. She realized that she blamed all of him for it. And he couldn't even accept that from her. He was like, no, I can't. I don't want to get that from you. I don't want to hear it.
Yeah, because she felt bad from blaming him, too.
Yeah. So this what this guy was going. And you can, what made it extraordinary for me with him acting is, before that, you was just like, man, this dude is just such an asshole. You know, just take care of your nephew. Stop being such an asshole. And then later on in the movie, you find out, he was still seeing the ghost of his children.
Yeah, yeah.
And he said, I can't get over this.
Yep.
And you're
and
like,
he had to leave the town.
And he just had to leave.
Yeah, but he did. I mean, he understood that he still had to take care of his nephew.
Yeah. He said, we're still going to have a relationship. Yep. I'm going to have a place for you so you can come, and I'll come back and see you. But our friend of the family is going to adopt you. I'm going to make sure you're straight.
Yeah, he did.
Even in the end, he could not get over it.
Yeah,
the ghost of his children, the fact that the town didn't forgive him.
Yeah.
He couldn't forgive himself. It wasn't like, I just got to take care of my nephew and that's all that mattered. He emotionally and mentally could not get over the death of his children. Which to me, if you put that all into the context of the movie and build that all the way up, that's why I thought this was pretty, pretty amazing. And that's why I can understand why he got the best actor. I kind of get that.
Right. Because the one thing is that you knew, it was like, he was that person. He really acted the role for that.
And that's what makes Casey so good.
I mean, so for him, he did an amazing job. He's always been a good actor. Yeah.
But he was this guy in this. You saw why he acted a certain way. You saw how he changed. You saw the happiness with his family. You saw his relationship with his nephew when he was smaller. Mm-hmm. You saw how much he loved his brother. You saw that, you know, even conflicts in the town, he wanted to try.
Yeah,
he was even trying to say, maybe I should.
Yeah.
It didn't work. He couldn't even have a relationship with people.
You know, and even the nephew, mom's coming into the picture after she was an alcoholic.
Yep.
And
abandoned him.
And he was telling his nephew, I don't know about your mom, man.
Yep.
I don't know about your mom. And what happened?
His mom came back with this religious zealot.
Yep.
And she was showing him that he was better, that she was better.
And
but
she wasn't.
She was different, but not better for him. So she still wouldn't have been a better mother for him.
Right. And, you know, even though Casey was trying to tell him, the mom just, like, abandoned him again.
Yep. Yep.
Yep.
And, you know, so his nephew was cool. He played a really good role, too. I think the young kid played really well there, too. Because he was just a kid.
Yeah.
He was like, hey, look, I got two girlfriends. Oh, I got a band. And I got to do hockey. He tried to live a normal life. And then all of a sudden, he just broke down one night. He just had a panic attack about his father. Before, he was kind of like, I get it. People feel bad for me. Yeah. I knew my dad was going to die. And then he had a panic attack.
Yep.
And he didn't know what to do. And Casey just came in and was like, look. Calm down, breathe. I'm not leaving the room. He said, why you kick my door in? What the hell is wrong with you? He said, hey, you need to calm the hell down, and I'm not leaving. But Casey just did extraordinary. I thought the whole movie was really, really good, and I thought Casey played an outstanding role. Now, toss up between him and Denzel, could have went either way. I think I lean a little toward Denzel, and this is the only reason why I lean a little toward Denzel. Denzel has been playing a couple of movies that he wasn't up to his potential, but this one, he just blew it away.
Yeah, he
blew it away. So to me,
that was amazing.
I would have sided a little more on Best Actor
for Denzel. Yes.
But I'm okay. I'm okay that they gave it to Casey.
Denzel, that was an amazing movie. It was. You're right about that.
I just thought that was pretty amazing. But, and I wanted to leave this one for last. No, but before last, there was two, Leisha, that we didn't see. Well, we saw one, but the other one we didn't see that they nominated.
Which was that?
I knew it was one more. I think it's called Hell or High Water. Hell or High Water. Has some good acting in there, a whole different one. But we'll see that a little later.
Yeah, we got time to see that.
That one and Hacksaw Ridge. I'm not going to see Hacksaw Ridge.
I'm just not seeing
What's his name?
Mel Gibson.
Yeah, Mel Gibson.
I'm not really
going to do that. But the other one was Arrival.
Oh, yeah, we seen that. And we
saw that. We loved that movie.
Yeah.
That was just so, it was a mental movie. So it was good acting, good visuals, good captivating movie.
It was so before its time.
Yep.
Almost like, you know, to be able to see, it's like seeing the future. Or, I really loved that movie.
Yeah, and it made you think through it because, you know, as you was looking at it, you was like, this is weird.
Yeah.
But they tried to keep you focused on the aliens. But it was all about her.
Right. It sure was.
It was just about her. It wasn't about the aliens. The aliens needed her. It was her. Mm-hmm. She was able to see the future. She was able to touch the future and know what should be done and what can be done.
Yeah, that was.
And they needed her help.
That was really, really good. Not a disappointment for that one either.
No, really not disappointed, you know. But, you know, since we didn't see that recently, we kind of passed that one over. So I apologize on that. But the last one is
LaLa Land.
Most touted, the big buzz,
LaLa Land.
The award winning LaLa Land.
LaLa Land.
So. What did we think about La La Land? So, real quick, not as good as people make it out to be.
Yes, I was not impressed with that.
Was not impressed. So, what Leisha and I talked about, and what the initial things that I said, when we saw Moulin Rouge,
yeah.
Amazing movie.
Chicago. Dream Girls.
Amazing movie. Dream Girls. Amazing movie. Ray,
yeah.
Amazing movie.
Yeah.
The Artist, the black and white one.
That was a musical, yeah.
Yeah. Amazing movie.
Yeah.
La La Land was okay.
Yeah.
It was okay. It was a creative way of doing things. Somewhat of a, yeah, that love story that was in there. It was pretty cool.
Yeah. But what's the name quitting that? Norsing.
But he's supposed to be a jazz artist, so he ain't really supposed to.
Like everybody was like, I noticed people was like,
Ryan Gosling.
Yeah, Ryan Gosling. Everybody was like, why was he in that?
Because he had to look, and that's what they wanted on there. Now Emma Stone, she should have. She was amazing.
Yeah, she was great.
Yeah,
she
was. I love the way.
Yeah, she was.
She acted throughout it because it was like, I want to be a good actress.
Yeah.
And she struggled so damn much.
Wow. Yes.
And you felt her struggle and she wanted to give up. And you just felt that all through that. So that's what made, to me, she made the movie.
She sure did. The director
made it really creative.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes creative don't make it the best.
Yeah. I was like, okay. All right. Yeah.
Singing was okay.
Yeah.
The little montages of dancing and all that, they were okay.
Yeah.
They weren't exciting to say, I love that. Because like when Chicago broke off and they started doing, I was like, oh, that is awesome.
Chicago was off the chain. Chicago was damn really good. So, yeah. There's really nothing to talk about La La Land because the story was about, it's a musical about, like you said, a woman
an actress
trying to make it in.
And a jazz
musician
want to bring back jazz.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, right.
That's it.
Yeah, but in Los Angeles.
Yes, Los Angeles.
So. Great scenery. They take you through Los Angeles.
Wait. So if everybody don't know, I mean, because I didn't know La La Land was Los Angeles until I saw the movie.
Bah.
Okay, so yeah, I didn't know. Just to say that.
So interesting though. So it was that, and it was just interesting. It was, and again, LA and the Hollywood loves musicals. So we haven't had a decent musical in a while. So I think the hype and everything went toward that. And to me, it was okay.
That's why you hear the silence, because it was a musical about an actress trying to make a success in Hollywood.
Yeah.
With the jazz musician trying to bring.
Bring back jazz.
That's all I could think about, what you said. That's all
it was
about.
But they were like, no, it was a love story. And you got to understand their relationship. And yeah, I like that. I think one of the most creative parts in the movie was in the end when they show the alternative.
Yeah.
I thought that was cool.
That was cool.
They should have kind of done that a little in the middle so you can get excited
about
it.
That was cool. And then they flip it, you know. Yeah, that was cool. But other than that, she drove a Prius.
Yeah.
I was like, really?
So that's what they do. But, you know, all the supporting actors and their actresses, they was okay. John Legend was the new wave jazz guy said, hey, look, this is the only way people are going to listen to jazz. And,
yep.
And it was terrible anyway, because I love jazz anyway.
He was cool in there. I mean, because
he was okay.
Yeah, because he was a singer.
Yeah. He was a singer and he was the band leader.
Yeah. So he played the part.
Yeah. So he was.
No.
He didn't play better than Ryan. Ryan was the character in there. Yeah. He just wasn't good enough.
Yeah.
I don't think. So if you look at that whole movie, I think if you would have put anybody in that position, it still wouldn't have made the movie better. I just think it would have made the movie different. I think based on the movie, let's go back on all of these movies now. Now, Manchester by the Sea, great story. The way they set it up was kind of like, wow, this is really pretty fucked up. Wow. And it was continued. And it built up to a climax to say, damn, now I kind of get it.
Right.
Love that. Arrival, same thing. You don't know what the hell's going on. It built up to a point say, wow.
But you can talk about the movie. You find things inside the movie that you can talk about. You can't do that in La La Land.
Well, you can if that's all you want to talk about. So think about it. If you want to talk about a musical, you talk about, oh, the songs are so cool. Yeah, the dance sequences.
I'm just talking about just La La Land.
No, I didn't think they were impressive.
Right. Okay, that's what I mean.
I don't think they stood out.
Like you said, we already mentioned all the other musicals that we have seen that are off the chain, because I still, to this day, will watch Dreamgirls over and over and over again.
Dreamgirls, Chicago.
I mean, come on now.
Ray, all of those.
But when you talk about La La Land, all I could do is like,
it was okay. It was so which makes it bad. This is, I'm sorry. I mean, if anybody loves it, then give me your input on that, because I'm pretty lost.
Well, all I can say is that.
So I'm looking at them. So let me read them all out. Moonlight, La La Land, mm-hmm. Arrival, mm-hmm. Lion, mm-hmm. Hell or High Water, Hidden Figures, mm-hmm. Hacksaw Ridge, Manchester by the Sea, mm-hmm. and Fences. So if you look at all of those, think about that. If you had a top three, from 3 to 1, so you're back in all the way to your number one. Let me give you two one more time. Moonlight, La La Land, Arrival, Lion, Hell or High Water, you didn't see, Hidden Figures, Hacksaw Ridge, Manchester by the Sea, and Fences.
You said Moonlight.
Moonlight?
Yeah.
Yeah, I said Moonlight, La La Land, Arrival, okay. Lion, Hell or High Water, Hidden Figures, Hacksaw Ridge, Manchester by the Sea, and Fences.
Three favorite ones off the bat. Fences, Hidden Figures, and Moonlight.
So, all the black movies.
Yeah, I didn't mean to do that.
No, that's fine. I'm just saying.
Yeah,
all black movies.
Well, see, Fences, like I said, we sat there. I cried in that one because, you know, our girl is in there, man.
So, Fences and Moonlight, I'm not sure which one what I would say is number one. So, whichever one is one, the other one is two. So I got those.
No, it could be a tie. It's not a problem having a tie because it's kind of hard to say which one.
No, so if you're given a top prize, you don't have a tie. You don't give the top prize.
Hidden Figures
as a tie.
Is my favorite.
So I don't think Hidden Figures was a different movie. I loved it. I thought it was relevant. I thought it was great. I still think Manchester and Arrival were two better movies.
Yeah,
because
I mean,
I liked the way it was written and directed.
And I understand that. And I totally understand that. I know Hidden Figures would never have won in the first place. That, mm-hmm. But it was so...
No, that doesn't make it a bad movie. So
but
don't
no, for
take
me,
it out of a
And I'm
a
saying
bad movie.
My favorites.
No, and that's all I ask you. Right. That's, it's nothing wrong with you having that. I'm just saying, when you look at those, when I started saying mine, I was flipping between Moonlight and Fences. Moonlight was so different of a movie. That's why I loved it. It was just so different. And you looked at the whole scheme and the way they chronologed his life with different characters and different
now,
characters
if you gave me
had
five,
to play that.
If you give me five.
So hold on, let me finish. And then Fences had the best acting out of all the movies.
Viola Davis, man.
Viola Davis and Blue Denzel Washington
was
best
amazing.
Actors and actresses in the whole set.
Yeah, that was amazing.
So if Viola went up against Emma Stone, I would have said Viola.
I would say Viola.
She was amazing.
Yeah, she
but
was.
But they were two different categories.
Right.
And I think that was weird that they did that.
Yeah, because they gave Viola supporting.
Supporting.
Yeah.
They didn't give her best.
Yeah.
Which I don't understand why. If she was side to...
Denzel.
No, Ryan Gosling, Emma. Then why wasn't Viola's side to Denzel?
Because they didn't want to put them two together. And
so that's,
I mean, that's what I would see it.
That's kind of fucked up. But if it gave her the award, I'm okay with that. You know what I mean?
Right.
If it gave her an award.
They gave it to her.
I'm okay with that. So, but my third one will probably be Manchester by the Sea. So I'm between Fences and Moonlight. And if I had to say anything, I probably would still say Moonlight. And then Fences, and then Manchester by the Sea.
And
but
see,
if yours was five, go ahead.
If it was five.
So go back again.
Arrival.
What's one?
One would be Fences,
mm-hmm.
Moonlighting.
Mm-hmm.
Then it would be Arrival.
Why did you say Hidden Figures?
That was three. That was my top three. But if I was to put five in there.
So if you said, if you put five in there, then, okay, do it one more time. I'm sorry.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do now.
Okay. So... Fences,
Moonlight.
Then Arrival.
Arrival.
Then Hidden Figures.
Mm-hmm.
Then Lion.
Then Lion.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Cool. And or anything. I mean, those were the ones that really gave me that emotion.
So I didn't see Lion. I didn't see Hell or High Water. I didn't see Hacksaw Ridge, which I didn't give a damn about. but I would have had back to my Moonlight, Fences. Manchester by the Sea, Arrival, and I wouldn't put La La Land ahead of Hidden Figures. I wouldn't. I think Hidden Figures was such a well-written and presented movie that I still liked it better than La La Land. I think La La Land was okay. I just don't think, based on the hype.
Yeah.
It
wasn't worth the hype.
So if they would have nominated for a lot of the choreography and all that, because there was nothing else out there that had choreography like that. So yeah, you got that.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of stuff. Emma, I probably give her the credit on that too. So because I don't think there was, like the other woman that was on Manchester by the Sea, I don't think she should have been nominated.
Wasn't it the mother?
The mother of his child.
Yeah, okay, the mother's
it was
child.
Her.
Okay.
In Arrival, she was great. I loved her in that, but I don't think she competed. Moonlight was supporting actress.
Right.
Hidden Figures was supporting actress.
Right.
And they couldn't fuck with Viola Davis.
No, they couldn't.
So
nobody knew. Everybody
I don't
think
knew. Anybody on the list
no.
could mess with her. Because when she shows up, She's like, what's her name?
She's like a Denzel of them.
No. The one that always gets nominated. And
Streep.
Meryl Streep.
Yeah.
She's the black
Meryl
Streep.
Yeah,
when she shows up, she shows up.
Yeah.
She's just
Meryl Streep is off the chain.
Yeah. So, but That's why I found that this year was a really good year, especially when we looked at all of these and was to say, yeah. But
and remember, I also watched the Will Smith one.
The
one when his daughter died or something like that.
Oh, okay.
But
that wasn't nominated.
No, but it wasn't. But, you know, for some reason, they keep trying.
So they trying to get Will Smith to get an Oscar. Get an Oscar, not a nomination anymore, because he got nominated.
Yeah.
He got nominated a couple of times. He didn't get nominated for Concussion. No. Because he had that fake African accent, then that was terrible.
I mean, each
tell the truth, tell the truth.
Yeah, every time they try, he's trying, and I can understand what he's trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that he needs to chill on it.
No, I think he needs to find a better director. No, in all honesty, if he finds a director that can actually highlight who he is and not make him something else, I think he'd be fine.
Mm-hmm.
Because he can play a good dramatic role. He's known to do that.
Muhammad Ali.
Yeah, that was just amazing.
Yeah.
So you can't tell me he can't do that.
Yeah.
And then what was the other one when he played the homeless guy?
Oh, I forgot the name of that one.
But he played great on that.
Yeah, with his son.
Yeah.
I remember that. Well, yeah, you're right. He sure did.
So he can do it. Get yourself a good director. Develop a story around your personality so you can be natural. Every time he tries to play somebody that he's not, he looks phony.
Yeah, he does.
And when he looks phony, it looks like he's acting. So when he looks like he's acting, I'm not impressed.
Yeah.
There's certain actors, let's go back to Casey. Casey always looked like that's who he is.
Right, right.
Denzel can change to anybody.
Yeah, brother man.
But that's who he is. Mm-hmm. He becomes that. The best actors become the person.
Right.
Actors make the role into who they are.
But remember, Fences is, I think, Denzel did that one too.
Yeah, he directed that.
Yeah, he directed that. But also, you know, he's just an amazing actor.
But he's just an amazing actor.
Yeah, he's just an amazing actor overall.
You can't take anything away from that.
Yeah,
guy.
You really can't. For him to do that, and like he said, I'm taking another break, do some awful movies.
Exactly.
But you know what? And so that is exactly right. So, but overall, all the movies we've seen were all good, all great movies. I will never, ever, 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 ever binge watch 8 hours worth of movie on a plane again because I was so damn tired.
It's a lot of good movies, though.
It was. I couldn't say no to it. I was like, oh, my God. I was tapping Michael. I was like, Michael, look at all the movies. And he was like, yeah, okay, whatever. And he went right to sleep. I'm up here like, oh, hell no, I got 8 hours.
So I did my 6 hours. I was 8 hours.
I said, let me start with this movie right now. And there was a couple of other ones I wanted to see, but I was like, damn. I said, I was hoping the plane coming back or some when I was coming back home, but they ain't had none of the other movies.
Yeah, it seemed like Delta had the best ones.
They did.
And then when we came back, it was either the ones I already saw or just a lot of trash.
Yeah.
And it was kind of like, here's some movies you could check out.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, I don't want to see none of these. So. Yeah.
Maybe going to California twice, so I'll get to see the other movies.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's our closing. But the good thing is we had some quality movies that was out. When we see Hella High Water, we probably do one on that. But I think we know what was the top five because we basically told you the top five based on the more popular movies that were competing. I think they're adding too many movies to the best picture. It's just too many movies. You don't have to have 8. You get a top five and then go from that. Your top five.
Weren't they talking about adding some more to it as well?
They was talking about something, which was is still to me, it's about being nominated. No, it's not. It's about winning.
Yeah, that's too many.
You know, you got the Golden Globes and what's it, People's Choice, and the SAG Screen Actors Guild.
SAG Green, yeah.
And it was one other one. But I forget. It's a couple of awards that lead up to the Golden Globes, the Screen Actors, that really says this is where we headed. And sometimes it's not necessarily the same winners. But you know they're being acknowledged. But that's where you got from that. So that's our Oscar closeout, because we're not going to go back in anymore. We're going to have to wait for the next year because they're building on the movies. And you know, at the end of the year, that's when all the big highlighted movies are coming out.
I think it starts October.
Yeah, I know, right? So we just look out for those. But that's it for BougieBlackBrother.com, Coffee Women in Tech, and Twitter at Fine Black Woman, and Bougie Black Bro. So text us, hit our website, chill out.
Twitter.
Yeah.
Tweet us.
Tweet at us. Facebook the same way. So hit us up, and we'll see you soon on Urban Lifestyle Cafe. Thanks.